Welcome to part two of Hearty's one-to-one with Albion legend Dick Knight.
I'd always had my eye on Steve Coppell.
Yeah. Who we eventually got.
Well, I eventually got him.
Via Martin Hinchwood, obviously.
Via Martin, because I tried to get hold of Steve Coppell throughout that summer as well, while I was still... Because I thought Cameroon could go to the final of the World Cup and he would get a job, you know, Bayern Munich or something. I had to develop another line. I was trying to get hold of Steve Coppell, who, funnily enough, was in the Far East. His agent, a guy called Athol Still, who was Sven-Goran Eriksson's agent and was mainly an opera singer's agent. He was Pavarotti's agent.
Oh, right.
Very interesting chap. He tried to get hold of Steve, who went AWOL in Thailand or something.
As you do.
As you do. Eventually, he came back, Steve, and it was... He came back from Hong Kong, where he was. He got off the aeroplane at Heathrow in the morning, on a Saturday morning, and he came to see me at this hotel in London, and he fell asleep.
Oh, dear.
And he won't mind me telling that, because I said, Steve, let's call it a day on this. You know, I can't, you know, you need to rest. You're not, you know, au fait with what I need to do at Brighton. I've got to make a decision. Yeah. It was about a week before the start of the season. So I decided to give the job to Martin Hinchwood, who'd been put in charge of the team before on other occasions. Yeah. And he knew what he was doing, Martin.
Another good football man, same as Mickey.
Hmm?
Another good football man.
Yeah. The only problem with Martin was what happened. He turned down the opportunity of getting Steve Sidwell and Kolo Touré from Arsenal on loan for the season. I took him to see an Arsenal friendly match, a pre-season game. Yeah. And these two players were playing without names on their backs. They just had numbers. Yeah. I went to see Steve Sidwell.
Yeah.
Because I, you know... Steve Coppell and I had talked about Steve Sidwell.
Yeah.
And I saw this big guy playing wide on the right, number seven, big black guy, who was excellent, absolutely excellent. So I'd said to Wenger at half-time, he said, Dick, you're happy with Steve? I said, yes, but who's that guy playing wide on the right, Arsene? And he said, you like him? So I said, yes. He said, you like his brother even more, but he's just gone to Barcelona.
Yeah.
So I said, well, what's his name? He said, his name is, the one we've got is Kolo Touré.
Kolo Touré, yeah.
But you can have him for the season because I want him to play championship level football.
But Martin turned it down.
So Martin, we got back into the car coming back to Brighton. And Martin famously said, I've not seen anything here that is any better than we've got at Brighton. Now, I'm using that as a quote, which is really a bit unfair on Martin.
And it's opinions.
But it's all about opinions. Yeah. Football, you know, Alex Ferguson made mistakes.
Oh, but he bought every some every manager.
Every manager.
Even Cluffy.
Klopp, Cluffy, they all make mistakes.
Now, I've got to ask you, how hard was it stepping aside so close to Falmer completing? I know the fans found it, but did you think it was the right time when you went in 2009?
Well, Tony, you know, we came to... I'd done the deal with American Express in June.
To actually sponsor the stadium.
To sponsor the stadium. Yeah. All based on the community side of the club. Because I knew that if I'd gone to, you know, the top people at American Express... with the idea that you should sponsor our club. We were in the third level of English soccer. You know, the idea... So it was all about community and corporate social responsibility, which I knew about because of my advertising marketing background. Yeah. So the whole of my pitch to American Express was about community. And we had... You know, our Albion in the Community was one of the best community schemes in the country. We developed it. Steve Ford and Alan Saunders and myself, I encouraged them to develop it.
Yeah.
So we had an incredibly good all-round community system scheme. And that's what I used to sell the stadium. So American Express agreed to do it, but they had to put it on hold because they told me that the worldwide credit crunch was coming up that autumn. So this was in June 2008 when I did the deal.
Oh, right.
And then in September, the crunch
came. Yeah, crunch came,
And, you know, everything had to go on ice, obviously, because there's no way that American Express are going to announce that they're sponsoring a Division III soccer club stadium. So it went on ice and for basically 18 months, by which time, during which time...
You had stood down.
But so Tony, made the offer that he would, subsidise any shortfalls. Because I said, either we're going to have to postpone this stadium because we cannot get into a building and then run out of money.
No.
Tony came to me and said, I'm prepared to subsidise any shortfall, but I want to become chairman now. So I was not happy with that, really, clearly, because I wanted to be able to take the club to the stadium, the new stadium, and then hand over to my successor, who would be Tony.
How much money have you put in?
I did it. I stood down at that time for the fans. We'd waited so long. Remember, it was 1997, and it was 12 years after we left the Goldstone.
Long time.
So I wanted to. I felt the fans can't wait any longer.
Did it for the fans.
I will stand down.
How much have you put into the club personally?
Well, I put into the club just under $3 million.
And did you know every time you wrote a cheque or every time you did a bank transfer, did you know in your heart of hearts you'd never get that money back?
No, I thought that I would get it back some way or the other. I never did it, to get my money back.
No.
I didn't do it to make a profit.
People don't.
I did in my book, because I felt fans are so important.
Yeah.
In my book, I offered people the chance to buy one of my shares or a few, whatever they wanted, at the par value. Yeah. I didn't want to make a profit. And do you know what happened? The response to that was I had applications for over 100,000 shares from about 600 people who wanted to buy shares in the Albion. Not because they wanted to take over the club.
No, but simply just they wanted to be part of...
They wanted to say...
Were they allowed to?
No, the club stopped me doing it. It was interesting because what people wanted, and they... I had to give in the form that I got to send in, they had to give a reason why they wanted the shares.
Yeah.
And they had to show me that they were a genuine Albion fan.
Yeah.
So many of them wanted them because they could say, I own a very tiny part
of my club.
Of the club that I helped to save.
That's
they
good.
Did.
Yeah, it's great.
So
great.
That's what I was my reason. Anyway, they decided they didn't want to do that. I respect that decision. Yeah. A lot of people were disappointed, but they're not disappointed now in the sense that the club.
No,
It says we got to
it
the
is different stages, and so 16th in the Premier League this year. We've had the COVID season. Have you been to any games this season?
No. No, I haven't been invited. I thought I might have been invited for the Man City game this week. I am still the life president of the club, but I haven't.
No.
I've watched virtually every game, of course, on television.
What have you thought of it? Have you enjoyed it?
I think I enjoy watching my team.
Yeah.
Clearly.
We all do.
And I think that Graham Potter has made the club, the team play a more attractive style.
Yeah.
However, I think that we still got a way to go. We don't want to be struggling on the edge of relegation every season. I know that Tony and
because you can't. The problem is, Dick, as you know, you've supported this club for a lifetime, and you know that there's a core support, and there's a butterfly support.
Yeah.
And unless you come up with the goods, you will eventually go down to the core support.
Yeah.
Now, which comes on to my next question, and I want to really touch on this, because of the project that you're embarking on, which...
But hang on a sec. Can I just say, because, I mean, in terms of the way that the team play, I like the way the team play.
But we need a goals scorer.
Yeah, we need a goal scorer.
But my question is, we're going to have to look at, and how do you think, as a former chairman, someone who... We may have to go and look at paying an Albion player £100,000 a week. Now, is that necessity or is that craziness? Or is football basically going to blow up in the ending?
Well, football in the Premier League won't, because the money is there. I believe that the money should be filtered down to the lower levels of football so that the pyramid is
which
protected.
Comes on to what you're doing
yeah,
now, which
we'll,
is...
We'll just come to that in a sec. The point is that £100,000 a week in the Premier League is not unusual at all.
But is it not obscene, Dick?
It depends what you think by obscene. We
just come past St James's Street and there are people begging.
Yeah, but you can't
on the street.
Really... I mean, if you compare it on that basis, then of course it's obscene. But if a market has got the money to pay a sum of money to the players, the players are the people that make the entertainment. Mm. And I believe there should be salary caps. There should be limitations on what players can be paid. But at the same time, for example, if Brighton went for Oliver Giroud as a striker, I think he would be ideal, as it happens.
You would like us to...
Well, hear me out.
Yeah.
If we went for Oliver Giroud, he would probably cost £100,000 a week, but he wouldn't cost a penny in transfer fees because he's out of contract. So you've got to take that into account.
But do we not have to give him a signing on fee?
You don't have to if you don't... I mean, I never paid a player a signing on fee, ever. And you don't have to do that. It's negotiable. But one thing you don't have to do is pay Chelsea £12 million.
Yeah.
You don't have to play the club because I'm pretty sure that he's out of contract. So what I'm saying is, if we'd had to pay £12 million, you've got to amortise that over, say, a two-year contract, which comes down to more than £100,000 a week.
It is.
Just for that alone.
Tell me about your latest project, though, because it's really interesting.
What I'm doing now is, it really stems from what happened when Bury went under. What happened, Bury fans, Bury staff of the club and the media came to me because of what we'd been able to do at Brighton. And they were asking my advice, how we could save Bury. Well, it turned out it was too late because the Football League had virtually no idea what was going on at Bury. And so the national press covered this story in relation to me quite substantially. Mm. And I started thinking that this has got to stop. You know, the league have to be in better financial control of their clubs. It's got to be mandatory. And, you know, and sure enough, what happened within a few weeks, Macclesfield went as well. Because the league didn't know enough about what was going on at those clubs. So I sat down with some tech people, you know, some data experts, specialists, and said, football needs a system, a governance system, which is tech-driven. It's real-time financial reporting of every club. So the league has a portal and the club feed in information. So that is called Club View, and I've been working on that since the autumn of 2019, which is when Bury went under. Mm. So this project is now at the point where we are pilot testing in the EFL, in the English Football League, at Salford City, Oxford United in Leagues 2 and 1.
Yeah.
Salford, Gary Neville is, you probably know, the driving force behind that. And I've been in touch with Gary through the government project, the pressure group Save Our Beautiful Game. Mm. David Davies, who set up the mediation for me against Archer, when he was at the FA all those years ago, is one of our advisors. Yeah. He's very highly respected, not only in British football, but also in European football. Yeah. I today, earlier this morning, sent an email to the head of Danish FA and to the Swiss FA over the weekend, because we're talking to those leagues about this reporting system. Mm. It's real-time reporting so that clubs can monitor the financial health of their... leagues can monitor the financial health of their clubs in real time.
And if we'd had it in 1993, 94, 95, Archer would never have done what he did.
He would not have been able to get away with it. Right. That is the point.
So are the government going to get you on board? Because they've got, haven't they got some sort of new think tank? The government have decided
to implement their manifesto, which is a fan-led football, review of football.
Yeah.
And of course, what happened in the Super League, those six clubs plus the other six in Europe, that was the straw that broke the camel's back, because you know the fans' reaction against it, but also, you know, the rest of the Premier League were against it, because they assumed that they could carry on playing in the Premier League or the German club.
German wouldn't do it, would they?
Fan-led, they're not allowed to do it. But in Spain and Italy, those clubs... they thought that they could still carry on playing.
Have their cake and eat it.
Yeah, and playing this weekday league, the Super League.
For the 300 million every year
and no relegation. Obviously, there was a huge furor against it, not just in the UK, but across the world.
So what did Boris say in his manifesto then? What did he promise?
He basically promised in their manifesto, this is in November 19, at the general election, that we would conduct a fan-led review of football governance and regulation. And my company, I'm the chairman of Clubview, this reporting system, financial reporting system, we're on the agenda in that review. Right. You know, we're very much centrally involved. We've met with Oliver Knight, who's the head of the DCMS committee, sport committee, Oliver Dowden, the culture secretary, and so on. So we're right into government as well as the clubs.
Have the government, with this manifesto promise, so have they got football people on this board?
They announced it on Friday, just gone. It's representative, but what struck me was that it's not really very representative of people who actually have run clubs.
Who have they got on there then?
Well, they've got a cross-section of people. They've got the head, quite rightly, of the Football Supporters Association. Yeah. Kevin Miles. They've got
knows his stuff though. He's a good lad.
He's good. They've got one or two former government advisors, which is obviously there to understand the legislation if they bring it in. I believe they will bring in independent regulation, and football, including the Premier League, will have to abide by it. Now, I think that the restrictions on the Premier League, because of the amount of money, I think that they will be instructed to make more money come down through the pyramid.
Yeah.
You know, what we've got to ensure is that the pyramid is protected. This is in every country, because the whole lifeblood of football, as you know, as any proper...
Yeah, it's the fans. Football, it's the fans and the smaller clubs.
Yeah,
and the chance of getting up the pyramid. Yeah,
of getting, you know, look, if we didn't have a football pyramid, Brighton, when I took over, we were bottom. Yeah. We're in the Premier League.
But when you're on the pitch at Edgar Street that day, and then nearly 20 years later, we were going up to the Premier League.
No, we weren't.
We were 97 to 2017.
Oh, you mean
20 years. So what I'm saying is that I never doubted. In my heart of hearts, I always dreamed that we'd get back to the Premier League.
Well, I knew that once we got the stadium, then anything was possible.
We would get there. So going back to that then, Graham Potter, can he get us into Europe? With Oliver Giroud?
I think without a doubt, we need a striker, a good striker, you know, an experienced striker. Or Olivier, as he prefers to be called. I think would be perfect for Brighton because he wants regular Premier League football. Yeah. He loves London. He wouldn't have to virtually move from London. He's great in the air. He's got good first touch. He can hold the ball up. You know, Trossard, you know, and let's say, hopefully, Tariq Lamptey will be back marauding down our right wing. They will have a target, you know, and I think he would love it here, Giroud, because he would be playing every week. He wants to stay in the Scottish, in the French national squad.
Yeah. Do you think Graham Potter is here for the long haul, though? Do you think he won't get enticed away?
I think.
I mean,
could.
Pep says he's the best English manager.
Yeah. I think that we've still got a lot to do. I think Graham has still got a learning curve. I mean, he's doing well.
Yeah.
And I think that he's got us playing good brand, a brand
attractive
of football.
Of
course, my favourite Brighton player, and I saw him, apart from Lewis, who joined the club when I was chairman, aged eight or whatever, is Yves Bissouma.
Yeah.
When I first saw him play for us in the opening game three seasons ago at Watford, he came on when we were 2-0 down and he changed the game.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, you know, Chris Hughton never really reckoned him.
No.
And I think even Graham didn't reckon him initially. He's only been playing regularly this
season. I don't think he'll play for the Albion again. I think he's going to go.
He's so good, Eve.
I think he's... I think like we did with Lawrenson in 81, you can only sell an asset once, and I think now is the time.
Yeah, but we don't really want to sell our best players, but it's whether... No, it's not...
But every club is a selling club.
No, no, but it's whether the player wants to go. In this case, I mean, I never stood in the way of Bobby Zamora.
Mm.
I did for a while because I said, you need a season in the Championship. And he and his dad, who was very influential on Bob, much more than his agent, he realised that. And it was a shame that Bobby was injured half of that season. Yeah. But he still benefited from playing a season in the Championship. With Yves Bissouma, you know, he's already good enough to drop into any world-class team. He's that good a player. And therefore, I think we will lose him. And the way he was pallying up with Pepe...
Yesterday, a little bit concerned.
I would think that he...
Maybe he's going to North London.
And he's also close, I think, to Partey.
Yeah.
You know, the other midfielder. I could just see him and Yves Bissouma holding, locking down those two central midfield positions, letting Saka and Smith Rowe and the forward player. I mean, you know, Yves is a wonderful player. I told him so about a month after he joined the club.
All good things must come to an end. I could sit here with you for hours. we could be burning the midnight oil. What will be your legacy? What would you like to be your legacy, apart from the benefit of every teenage boy, the Wonder Bra commercial with Eva Herzegova or whatever her name
was? Yeah, well, Eva was one of my legacies, I guess.
So what would your legacy be? I mean, you are the man that saved the Albion.
That's one legacy, and I'm very proud of that, and people have never forgotten that. I mean, they come up to me in the street and say, I'd like to shake you by the hand, Mr. Knight, for what you did to save our club and develop the club. It wasn't just saving it.
No,
let's face it, we got to the Championship.
Playing at the Wifting.
Yeah, I mean,
in
that
the Theatre of Trees.
That was one hell of a achievement. So I managed to get the club on the right rails in many respects. But I think that, you know, I'm in my 80s. I don't feel in my 80s. And I'm this project, this football governance project that and sustainability project, I want my legacy to be that football leagues and football clubs have got a better chance of surviving in the future. I mean, they've been hammered by the pandemic. The financial implications of that are huge. But I know that football clubs have got to be accountable to the leagues in terms of being able to be run properly. The leagues need to take the leadership in it in order to insist that their clubs follow these financial rules. If you don't want to agree with that, then go and play in another league. If the government in this review simply brought that in and said all the clubs in English football must abide by the following financial rules. If they don't, they can go and set up their own league. The answer is they will do it because they've been told they have to do it.
Dick, thank you very much. That's all for this time. Join me next time. Thank you for watching.